inconsistencies from different cities to towns. Now, you might say, well, they are different and unique in their own way, and sometimes they have to be different. But let's keep in mind what this legislation is about. This is about building houses in special flood zones that are shown on the FEMA flood insurance rate. So in this case, I think the state needs to have a consistent law regarding what can and cannot be done in these flood zones, because the builders need to know what they are, not go to 39 different cities and towns and get 39 different answers. I think this is a good bill, and I urge you to support it. Thank you.
Representative Filippi.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. For point of clarification, the prior language said that the distance may exclude spires, chimneys, flagpoles, and the like. It was permissive and enabling on behalf of municipalities. The new language says it shall exclude those items. So it is a substantial change. Thank you.
Representative Chippendale.
Thank you, Speaker. I think Rep. Edwards brought up a fairly good point to the and the likes. In your experience, and you can nod your head, you don't have to yield, we have a lot of ham radio folks up in my district with like 35-foot antenna off their side of their houses, obviously unoccupiable. Would that be an and the like type of a situation?
Whip Edwards, if you're going to answer it for the body with your mic. Whip Edwards.
Generally, it would be, yes. Those, so, they would be built to a very specific structural code.
So that would not impact, or it would?
It would not. It's and the like, so it would be something that would be going up separately. It wouldn't be a part of your house. It would be blocking someone else.
All right. I appreciate you yielding. Thank you.
There are no other lights. Clerk, unlock the machine. All those in favor, please vote green. Those opposed, red. Clerk, lock the machine. 56 in favor, 10 opposed. The act prevails. Next item, clerk.
Item 14, number 7742, sub A.
Chairman Craven.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This bill comes to us from Chairman Ruggiero and Chairman Abney. This measure would extend the date upon which construction permit fees assessed by all municipalities must be computed according to a formula approved by the Rhode Island Building Code Commission. It changes it from January 1st, 2016 to July 1st, 2016 to July 1st, 2017. It's a good bill. I move passage.
Chairman Craven moves passage. That is seconded by Representative Carson. Chairwoman Ruggiero, Chairman Azzanaro, Whip Edwards. There are no lights. Clerk, unlock the machine. All in favor, please vote green. Those opposed, red. Clerk, lock the machine. 66 in favor, 0 opposed. The act prevails. Next item, clerk.
Item 15, number 7793.
Chairman Abney.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Bill number 7793 comes to us from Representative Canario. It authorizes Portsmouth to issue up to $10 million in bonds for a new police station subject to local voter approval. There's no state fiscal impact. I move passage.
Chairman Abney moves passage. That is seconded by Whip Edwards, Representative Hull. There are no lights. Clerk, unlock the machine. All those in favor, please vote green. Those opposed, red. Clerk, lock the machine. 65 in favor, 0 opposed. The act prevails. Next item.
Item 16, number 7865.
Chairman McNamara.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. House Bill 7865 by Representative Ackerman would require institutions of higher learning to adopt a policy which grants amnesty for violations of drug alcohol policies for those who report incidents of violence, including domestic violence, dating violence, stalking, and sexual assault. It is supported by the University of Rhode Island, Rhode Island College, the ACLU, and many, many others. It's good public policy that will improve the safety of all of our students that are attending colleges. I move passage.
Chairman McNamara moves passage. That is seconded by Representative Kazarian, Representative Coughlin, Representative Blazejewski, Representative Hearn, Chairman Abney, Representative Maldonado, Representative Fogarty, Representative Ackerman, Representative Amori, Representative Carson, Representative McEntee, Chairman Craven, Representative O'Brien, Representative Almeida, and Representative Constantino, as well as Representative Yucci, Chairman Shikachi, and Representative McLaughlin. There are no lights. Clerk, unlock the machine. All those in favor, please vote green. Those opposed, red. Clerk, lock the machine. 65 in favor, 0 opposed. The act prevails. Next item.
Item number 17, number 7890.
Chairman Shikachi.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, this bill 7890 comes to us from Rep. Ruggiero. This bill would add workforce training for the skills to be considered related to green energy sector, as it's necessary to have employment training in solar installation for electrical apprentice programs and energy efficient programs. This bill came out of House Labor Committee on a 10-0 vote. There was no opposition. Department of Labor and Training supported it, and I move passage. It's a good bill, Mr. Speaker.
Chairman Shikachi moves passage. That is seconded by Representative Phillips, Representative Bennett, Representative Fallela, Chairman Abney, Representative McEntee, Representative Carson. There are no lights. Clerk, unlock the machine. All in favor, please vote green. Those opposed, red. Clerk, lock the machine. 67 in favor, 1 opposed. The act prevails. Next item, clerk.
Item 18, number 7897, Sub A.
Chairman McNamara.
Thank you. House Bill 7897, Substitute A by Chairman Keable, would establish a 5-member board of acupuncture and oriental medicine within the Department of Health and provide for the removal of board members for unprofessional conduct. It's an up-and-coming field that will bring some of these folks together. It's a good bill, and I move passage.
Chairman McNamara moves passage. That is seconded by Chairman Azzanaro, Representative McLaughlin, Representative Bennett. Leader Newberry.
Just a quick question, please, for the floor manager, if I could.
He will yield.
Yes.
I vaguely remember this bill from last year, and if I ask this question, I apologize, but back when I was in college in 1989, the local Progressive Student Alliance engaged in, I don't want to call it a jihad or a crusade, I don't want to say that, but a passionate effort to convince the university to change the name of the Department of Oriental Studies because they said it was racist. So my question is, have things changed? Is Oriental no longer racist? Were the progressives simply wrong, as they often are back in 1989? Or why are we using the terminology? I don't really care. There's got to be a reason for this. I didn't have an opinion either way, but is this what the industry calls itself now?
Yes.
Are we going to be criticized for this?
No, we won't be criticized for this. It is accepted by both groups of acupuncturists in the state. There are some that are more progressive, and there's others that are more formally tied. So everyone is on board with this, and those professionals think that this is the right thing to do.
Well, I'm sure it's a good bill. I'm glad to know, Mr. Speaker, that what was politically incorrect 27, 8 years ago is no longer politically incorrect. It's good to see that happen.
There you go.
Representative Chippendale.
Thank you, Speaker. Just would like to be recorded in the affirmative on item number 16. I was not in the chamber for the vote.
So ordered.
Thank you. And relative to the last comment, Oriental is used to describe objects and things. Asian is used to describe people, so it's not an issue. Thank you.
There are no lights. Clerk, unlock the machine. All those in favor, please vote green. Those opposed, red. Representative Farris, vote, please. Clerk, lock the machine. 68 in favor, 0 opposed. The act prevails. Representative Canario.
Mr. Speaker, could I be recorded the affirmative on that vote?
You may, so
ordered. Thank you.
Next item.
Item 19, number 7913, Sub A.
Chairman Handy.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. 7913A by Representative Malik. We actually passed this earlier this year. The Senate made a small Sub A, really nothing substantive. They've just changed some of the names of some of the bodies that they're working with along the way. It's something important to get the Underground Storage Tank Financial Responsibility Review Board functioning again. And I move passage, Mr. Speaker.
Chairman Handy moves passage. That is seconded by Representative Yuchi, Representative Tansey, Chairman Malik, Representative Bennett. There are no lights. Clerk, unlock the machine. All those in favor, please vote green. Those opposed, red. Clerk, unlock the machine. 70 in favor, 0 opposed. The act prevails. Next item.
Item 20, number 7963.
Chairman Abney.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Item number 7963 comes to us from Representative Giarrusso. It authorizes East Greenwich to issue up to $5 million in bonds for roads and sidewalks subject to local voter approval. There's no state fiscal impact. I move passage.
Chairman Abney moves passage. That is seconded by Representative Chippendale, Representative Roberts, and Chairwoman Ruggiero. Representative Nunes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Out of an abundance of caution, I'd like to recuse myself on this due to the fact I've done some sidewalks for the town of East Greenwich in the past. Thank you.
Clerk, please send the recusal form to Representative Nunes. Deputy Speaker Lima.
Question of the sponsor, please. Representative Giarrusso, when did you put this in? Oh, March 18th. It wasn't fast-tracked, was it?
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. There are no lights. Clerk, unlock the machine. All in favor, please vote green. Those opposed, red. Representative Hearn, vote, please. Clerk, lock the machine. 68 in favor, 0 opposed. The act prevails. Next item, clerk.
Item number 21, number 7975.
Chairman Craven.
Hang 1 minute, Mr. Speaker. This bill comes to us from Representative Marshall. The measure allows the town of Bristol to postpone its full revaluation update from 2016 to the year 2019. The measure is necessary because the statistical evaluation in Bristol ran into logistical problems. Say that five times fast. And must conclude before the real estate revaluation can begin. It's a local bill. I move passage.
Chairman Craven moves passage. That is seconded by Chairman Shikachi. There are no lights. Clerk, unlock the machine. All in favor, please vote green. Those opposed, red. Clerk, lock the machine. 69 in favor, 0 opposed. The act prevails. Next item. Next item.
Item number 22, number 7988.
Chairman McNamara.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. 7988 by Representative Palangio would require the State Board of Education to approve driver education courses for new drivers. It would also allow instruction for parents and guardians of young drivers to be made available online as well as in the classroom setting at no cost. It's supported by AAA, driving schools, the Rhode Island Superintendent Association, and there was no opposition. I move passage.
Chairman McNamara moves passage. That is seconded by Representative McLaughlin, Chairman Azzanaro, Representative Bennett, Representative O'Brien, and Representative Williams. Leader Newberry.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Members of the House, if you look at page 2, line 30, 31, it talks about the course of instruction for the applicant's parent, guardian, et cetera, and the existing law provided for an optional and voluntary course. This changes it to a required course. Now, I realize further down in that paragraph going on to page 3, it says that the applicant doesn't have to pay for this required course. However, if, for example, you have three children, this, as I read this, each time one of my kids gets a driver's license, I'm going to have to take a required course, online or not, it's not the point. I have to take a required course as a parent? I don't know if I'm misreading this, and if I am, someone please tell me. But I don't see any logic in making me take, and my wife take, a required course for each child, let alone at all. I don't know why. I mean, I've been driving for a long time. I teach my kids to drive. My daughter has her license. I don't see why I have to take a course at all. So I don't think it should be required, period. It certainly shouldn't be required multiple times. And what also troubles me is if you read further down, I know the applicants don't have to pay for it, but somebody's going to be charging for this course. They may be charging the driving school, which will then pass it on through higher rates they charge the customers. But I see AAA is actually in the legislation. That would be, I assume that's the American Automobile Association. I know that's existing law. I don't know when that was passed, but I find it very uncomfortable that there's a private business entity in a Rhode Island statute in the first place. And if I'd been here, maybe I was. I don't remember. When that became law, I certainly wouldn't have supported it. This sounds to me as though AAA is trying to get the state to maybe up what they can charge, whether it's not directly to the applicant, to CCRI or to the driving schools, et cetera. This whole thing smells. It's going to be inconveniencing your constituents, the parents. It's going to be irritating your constituents. And this is just not a good piece of legislation, at least not that section. So I suggest we vote this down. I don't really see any benefit to it at all, except to AAA.
Representative Solomon.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Request to be recorded in the affirmative on item number 19.
So ordered. Representative Ucci.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, out of an abundance of caution, I'll be recusing on this matter. Thank you.
Clerks and Representative Ucci, a recusal form, please. Representative Costa.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I would like to be recorded no on number 13. And yes, on 14 to 21, please.
Did you previously vote, or you're not
no.
changing your vote?
Okay. I was not in the chamber, sir.
So ordered, clerk.
Thank you.
Representative Morgan.
Thank you, Speaker. I do have a question on the bill. I guess it's the chairman.
Chairman McNamara will yield.
Absolutely.
Is this intended that parents who want to teach their children how to drive will have to take this course?
Yes, it is, Representative Morgan, and let me tell you why. This year, I received a letter. I think other people received a similar letter from a student at North Kingston High School requesting, as you know, we have a graduated driver's license that limits the number of passengers that a newly licensed permit holder can drive with to one. The students were saying, the student that sent me the letter said he did a survey of his classmates, and the fact of the matter is none of his classmates' parents knew that there was this restriction. So he requested that we eliminate that particular provision and put it to no restriction. And part of the process that the graduated driving license procedure has involved requires that parents cooperate in so many hours of supervised driving with their child. And it also requires parents have to have an understanding of what's in the bill, because as you know, being a parent, that many times you are the ones that set these limits. And also, when that law initially passed and there was that late night driving prohibition, many parents said, hey, I'm glad that that was included in the law, because it really helps us out when we can say, yeah, this is the law. You can't take six kids in the car. You just got your license. You're limited to one. So it's a very important function of the law. I hope that helps you a little bit.
That does, but many parents work hard. They're busy on the weekends. Now we're asking them to go and take a course.
That's why
excuse me, I'm not finished. Yep. For seriously, decades, parents have been teaching their kids how to drive. If the parents need to understand that they must drive with their child because of this, there must be an application when the child is going for that graduated driver's license. Can't we just inform the parents at that time what their responsibilities are instead of making them go to CCRI and take a course? I mean, this is really an imposition on those parents.
Well, this is it'll be available online. I think that parents could read it within a relatively short period of time. And I think today, Representative Morgan, parents want to know what their responsibility is as a supervising driver, which is in the initial statute, what is required of them, and more importantly, what is required for their children to comply with the law. Because we have to remember the ultimate aim of this is to produce safer drivers. And 37 years in education, I've never met a parent that wasn't concerned about all of these issues. And I spent a lot of time in high school parking lots, speaking with parents, seeing kids get out of school, get behind the wheel with the parents that are there. So do parents play a critical role? Absolutely. Can that role be enhanced? And can we help parents by helping them know what the law is? Absolutely. That's what this does.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Comments, though. Parents are very, very busy. They do want their children to be safe. They do want their children to follow the rules and drive safely. But this is an imposition to them. It's an imposition on their time. I guess you say it's going to be online. I think we could do it in a way. We could inform parents of their responsibilities in a way that doesn't impose upon their lives as much as a course at CCRI.
Representative Chippendale.
Mr. Speaker, having just gone through this process with my daughter, who at the time was a minor child, I was required to be at the registry while she took her exam for her permit. Furthermore, once she was granted the right to drive, I was furnished with documentation that explained all the restrictions on her license. This just happened a year and a half ago. So this is duplicitous. And again, I think with the reference to AAA, I think we can kind of glean exactly what's going on here. There really is no need for this. This information is readily available, and in fact, you're required as a parent to be at the registry for that minor child. So I can't support this.
All right. Next time there's an innuendo, I'm going to ask for a complete and full explanation. So fair warning to all, be willing to explain what your innuendo is in the future. Representative Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Out of an abundance of caution, I will be accusing myself on this item. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative. Clerk, please send Representative Constantino a recusal form. There are no other lights. Clerk, unlock the machine. All those in favor, please vote green. Those opposed, red. Clerk, lock the machine. 50 in favor, 16 opposed. The act prevails. Next item.
Item 23, number 7992.
Chairman Abney.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Item 7992 is by Chairwoman Ruggiero. It authorizes Middletown to issue up to $10 million in bonds for school repairs, subject to local voter approval. The fiscal impact estimate for the state is, in fiscal year 18, $116,667, and then $231,159 each year thereafter. It's a good bill, and I move passage.
Chairman Abney moves passage. That is seconded by Representative Phillips, Representative Giarrusso, Representative Carson. There are no lights. Clerk, unlock the machine. All those in favor, please vote green. Those opposed, red. Chairman Abney, vote please. Clerk, lock the machine. 68 in favor, 0 opposed. The act prevails. Next item, clerk.